Forgive my interruption.
Do not apologize, my son. Father Tobias Whittaker is always happy to teach mortals about the incoming Armageddon.
I am Dr. Jonathan Reed, and I just have a few questions.
A scientist? You are much more lost than I thought, my son.
Do you know Nurse Dorothy Crane from the Pembroke Hospital? I'd like to know more about her.
I don't like the liberal ideas of nurses, but I especially abhor that Nurse Crane you mentioned.
So you're not exactly a fan of Florence Nightingale's work. But nurses are essential for modern healthcare.
Nuns should be the only women allowed to take care of male patients. It's obvious only they have the necessary moral fiber.
Why do you hate Nurse Crane more than other nurses?
Before coming to London, she was a member of the communist resistance in our country. That's what happens when you let a woman get involved in politics.
What do you mean when you say that I am more lost than you thought?
All scientists are entangled in a world of causes and consequences. And most of them can't see the plain truth.
Quite a judgmental opinion, if you ask me. But what do I know, blinded by science as I am?
But you are seeking answers, aren't you? Answers about the Armageddon about to strike the city. Answers about the hidden truth.
Well, I suppose I can spare a few minutes listening to your so-called truth.
As a doctor, you must be aware of a decimating epidemic. But let me tell you that this so-called Spanish flu is just the beginning of the end.
What do you mean?
The beast is finally revealing itself, corrupting the flesh and the heart of men. With my own eyes, I have seen them, those minions from the abyss.
Really? And what would be your answer to this biblical threat?
We must fight the disease before this legion outnumbers us. But not with scalpels and microscopes. No.
What is left then?
Cleansing fire.
Tell me, Tobias, what exactly is your plan concerning the cleansing of this city?
God will recognize his own. More than once, this city has risen from the ashes, hardened and purified by the flames.
Fire is just the instinctive answer of a caveman facing something he does not understand. This is the 20th century.
Your lack of faith is predictable. But my task is to convince rational minds like yours to see the light. This is God's will.
You're mad and dangerous. You're nothing but a soulless butcher. A small-time Torquemada. The Savonarola of Whitechapel.
My son, if you think salvation is a free gift, go listen to the lies of that pompous fool, Joseph.
Joseph, a fool?
Vicar Larrabee of St. Mary's Church. While he continues preaching his fraudulent redemption, more and more people die in the streets.
Have you any friends? Any family left in these terrible times?
No. But I have a disciple I see as my son. He is so devoted. I sent him to preach the good word in the heart of this corrupted city.
Where did you send him?
I sent Samuel to the Stonebridge Cemetery, where the pestilence and evil grows night after night.
You sent him on some preaching crusade during the epidemic.
As a true believer, Samuel will fear no evil while he walks through the valley of the shadow of death.
I have heard enough for tonight. Goodbye.
Good evening, sir. I'm Dr. Reed. I would like to ask you a few questions.
Please be my guest. Although I may not be the best informant regarding this part of town, my words speak about that which the eyes cannot see.
Really? Are you an artist of some kind?
I'm a poet, sir. Richard Nithercott, at your service.
May I ask what you're doing at this hour of night, sir? Do you live here?
Not at all. I'm just enjoying the pleasure of a quiet walk. Though night talks are always preferable, if you ask me. Especially with strangers.
But are you not afraid of the epidemic?
Oh, why should I? I see some equity in the Spanish flu. No flesh should be saved, say the scriptures. Good or evil, rich or poor, all are equal in the eyes of the flu.
If you say so. But as a physician in a time of epidemic, I must caution you to avoid unnecessary exposure, sir.
Thank you, Doctor. But we both know the seeker of truth has to go boldly where the weak dare not.
What are your thoughts on the terrible situation in this city?
Terrible, you say? No. Of course, the death of so many innocents is a tragedy, but the scourge has not been all bad for the city. Oh, no, sir.
What are you talking about?
Do you remember London before the flu? Noisy, cacophonic, quiet, nowhere to be found. And now, listen to this oddly peaceful silence.
Peaceful? That's quite an unusual way to speak about the epidemic. And very inappropriate, I must say.
Most people fail to understand my perspective. I don't blame them. But how could I call myself a poet if I veiled my feelings?
Are you aware that your life could be in danger in this part of town?
But this is where I must be to feel the real beat of the city. I had to come, see it for myself, alone.
If some misfortune came upon you, who would be here to help you?
Well, you, for a start, my dear doctor.
I understand your need for solitude, but it's not safe around here.
I don't care. I don't have many friends, Doctor, and my family despises me.
Tell me, Mr. Nethercott, why seek inspiration in Whitechapel?
The place is not beautiful per se, but how to explain it? Stirring and challenging.
Do you not think it a little morbid?
On the contrary, sir. Whitechapel is full of life, full of beauty. Just like my dear muse, the wonderful Camellia.
What can you tell me about Camellia?
Not much. And that's the beauty of it. She can't speak, you know. She's a locked mystery who exhales kindness and sweetness.
And have you ever tried to learn more about her? Where she lives, how she survives, whom she may know?
Maybe I prefer she remains an enigma. Reality can be so dull, don't you think?
Perhaps you're just afraid to find out the truth about your muse.
One day, perhaps, I'll ask her to come with me. But will she still be my wild flower of Whitechapel if she moves uptown?
In what way, exactly?
The struggle by gaslight, the barren smiles, and the added hunger under the rain.
If you say so.
Such vibrant antagonism and vivid paradox, the stripped humanity raged across each street.
Vivid, of course, yes. And what about the poignant distress?
Oh yes, the poignant distress. You see what I mean, don't you? That's what I want to write about, and that's what Whitechapel is made of.
May I ask you a few questions about the district?
Extraordinary part of town, is it not? I'll be glad to help you, if I can.
I'm looking for Dorothy Crane, a nurse who lives in this vicinity.
Dorothy Crane. Oh, I love the name. The Crane of Whitechapel. Sounds very mysterious. But, sorry, no, never heard of her.
What can you tell me about an old man called Darius?
Darius Petrescu? Yes, I know him. At first, I thought he was only a small publisher. I invited him to publish my work, but his reaction was pretty clear.
Not interested in your talent?
Darius is an old political activist who takes delight in printing tracts and lampoons. Those communist activities only require mediocre writing skills.
I'll leave you alone, sir. Good evening, Mr. Nethercott.
And good evening to you too, my good sir. Can I be of any help?
Do you need medical attention, sir?
It may be wise to let you prescribe me something. I don't feel like I should.
I understand your appetite for words and macabre beauty, sir. But you should be more careful.
The nutrition of my mind is more important than my physical health. But I appreciate your concern, sir.
I'll leave you alone, sir. Good evening, miss. I'm Dr. Reed. I'd like to ask you a few questions. I know what you're thinking. A tall stranger who meets a girl in the street at night. It reeks of the penny dreadfuls. But I mean you no harm, truly. I know you understand what I'm saying. Your silence has nothing to do with you being mute, does it? Tell me about Richard Nithicott. I understand he is quite fond of you. Camellia, I know you work for Dorothy Crane. Please tell me about her secret dispensary. A stubborn and mute comrade. Nurse Crane and Darius Petrescu have been clever. Very well. Goodbye then. Hello again, miss. Very well. Goodbye then. The content of Darius' letter to his children could give me more leverage to enter. Darius is a bit less of a mystery now. It should not be that difficult to incite him to let me in.
Protection against malevolence and trickery. Thank you.
Not exactly a treasure chest. A battered box, some knickknacks, and a letter.
Thank you. best stay back, sir.
Get their weapons ready! We found one! Vicious bugger!
Welcome, sir.
Please, take a browse of my wares.
I am Dr. Reed. I would like to ask you a few questions, if you don't mind.
Doctor? Interesting. I'm Barrett Lewis. Usually I don't have time to waste with talk, but at this hour of the night I can hardly refuse.
How is business around here?
Business? I have no business. Between this racket, theft, and customers getting scared, I'm losing money every day.
I see. Sounds like you blame someone in particular for your situation.
It's no secret Joe Peterson spends his time harassing merchants. But with me, he's trying to put me out of business once and for all.
As a merchant, you see Whitechapel every day. Have you noticed anything out of the ordinary recently?
Well, you mean besides the epidemic, the war, and all the usual crap? As long as I can remember, this part of town has been a bottomless pit, and no sign of the bottom yet.
Violence is increasing in the borough.
Yeah. A few nights ago, some blokes jumped me. Came out of one of the condemned workshops. Fever. Madness. Something like that.
Where did this happen? Why did you go there?
In the closed workshops nearby. I worked there as an apprentice in better days. Now I only go to find trinkets or tools. Too bad I was mugged, though. There was good money in that little box of loot I lost.
Have you been hurt?
No, but that's only because I ran like hell. Those men were raving lunatics, I tell you. Not even able to speak anymore, just screaming.
Have you heard of a nurse called Dorothy Crane?
Nurse Crane? So the bitch really is a nurse, then? Always thought she was just some crafty foreigner, that one.
Yes, she's a nurse, and quite a good one. What did she do to gain such notoriety?
Dorothy Crane ain't even a real name. Something like Dorothea Craniu, something like that. Came to England fleeing the war, I was told.
That doesn't explain why she irritates you so much.
Your precious Nurse Crane gives away medical supplies and prescriptions for free. I offered to sell it for a fair cut, but no. Miss Crane wanted to play the quiet saint.
Right then. Show me what you have. Mr. Petrescu, just 1 minute, please.
You again. Go away.
Sir, wait. Stop this nonsense. I know Nurse Crane is here. Shall we speak man to man, you and I?
All right. Speak up.
Don't you see we're on the same side? We fight to help the poor, sick, and abandoned.
I'm nothing like you, Mr. Doctor.
Yes, you are. You too believe in providing medical care without charge. You know what we have to sacrifice to make the world a better place.
I have to admit your words have conviction. All right, I'll let you see Dorothea. Don't make me regret this, though. If you want to talk to Dorothea, you must go across the courtyard and take the stairs.
We've not been formally introduced. May I ask your name and occupation, sir?
I am Darius Petrescu. I'm here to keep snitches and spies away from Dorothea. And I also run this little print shop.
Do you need some help, Mr. Petrescu?
I am very tired, but that is all. I don't need you, Doctor.
Well, I think you do. Take this, and you'll feel better.
Free drugs from an English doctor? It must be my lucky day.
So Dorothy's real name is not Crane?
Like myself and many people in this area, Dorothea is from occupied Romania. That's all you need to know.
She seems important to the community.
More than you can imagine. The West End does not want to hear of Whitechapel's misery. Dorothea is one of the few doing something about it.
Tell me everything you know about Camellia, the mute florist.
I do not believe in the afterlife, Doctor, but I'm almost convinced Camellia is an angel. She volunteered to give out our medical leaflets.
Are you not worried for her safety?
She is as brave as she is tough, and clever, too. If only I had met her when I was younger.
Are you in love with Camellia, Mr. Petrescu?
Don't be stupid. If I had met her when I was younger, we could have won our revolution.
Who is she, really? Do you know where she's from?
She's not from around here, that's all we know. Camellia is not even her name. It's her favorite flower.
You say she has no close family.
Well, there's that awful poet who constantly follows her around like a lost puppy. A good man, for sure, but a very poor writer.
Tell me everything you know about Camellia, the mute florist.
I do not believe in the afterlife, Doctor, but I'm almost gone.
Do you have any family left, Mr. Petrescu? Children or grandchildren?
Who knows? I have abandoned my people for so long, they might as well be dead. As dead as I am for them, I suppose.
Don't be embarrassed, sir. If you must know, my own father disappeared many years ago, and I forgave him.
It's quite awkward to talk about our families like this, but thank you, Dr. Reed. I appreciate your trust.
This war won't last forever. Did you ever think of returning to your country now it's free?
No. I have taught strength and determination to my sons and daughters. I'm an old, dying man who only has memories of better times to cherish.
I know you fought for your country when it was occupied, Darius. Tell me more about it.
I know my days are numbered, and I know I won't see my homeland again. But I fought for Romania all my life, and I will until my last breath.
But Romania escaped the grasp of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. It's a free country again.
But it's not the country I fought for. My homeland is not appeased, Doctor. And I still see a dark future ahead for my people.
How did you meet Nurse Crane, Darius? Why does she trust you?
I'm her oldest friend in England. Dorothea and I share many ideas about this country and about the country we left.
You mean occupied Romania, don't you? Even if not directly, I fought against your enemies.
Really? Then perhaps you have more in common with Dorothea than meets the eye, Dr. Reed.
Goodbye, Mr. Petrescu.
Patient Razvan Vasily, high fever running on 3 days. Complaints of dizziness, muscle aches, and head pain, diagnosed with influenza.
Treatment?
Aspirin and salicin for the fever and discomfort. Liquids for dehydration, but he's having trouble keeping even water down.
Aspirin and salicin, you say? Why not some warm milk and a kiss on the cheek? Where are the quinine salts?
Tried buying, borrowing, even stealing. There's none to be found, Doctor.
He's not convulsing, he's choking. He's not getting any air. Scalpel, hand me that scalpel.
What can I do, Doctor?
It's too dangerous to operate with these convulsions. Sedative, nurse. Do we have any anesthetics?
I'm sorry, Doctor, none at all.
I need to perform a tracheostomy. Short pipe. That rubber tube will do. We're going to cut a passage for air through the neck.
Yes, Doctor. He's breathing again, but he's coughing up blood.
Internal hemorrhaging. I need to make another incision into the chest cavity to drain the fluids from the lung. Prepare another tube.
A thoracostomy? Doctor, we've nothing to fight the infection. We need an aseptic environment.
Right then, Nurse Crane. What do you suggest we do?
I've no idea. I'm not the doctor.
Time is of the essence. We need to perform a thoracic drain.
Yes, Doctor. He's still bleeding, Doctor. I'm losing his pulse.
The drain must have punctured the intercostal artery. There's too much blood.
Are you all right, Doctor?
I can't see. I must first suture the artery. Find the wound. The source of the blood.
Needle and thread, Doctor.
Good. The stitches are holding. How's he doing?
We're losing him. We've lost his pulse. He's dying, Doctor!
Cardiac massage, now.
Cardiac... what? Are you making this up as you go along? We've lost the pulse. He's gone, Doctor.
Nurse, we did everything we could.
Truly? Everything you could? Is that how you'll report this in your log? Is this how the war went? Piling up one poor corpse beside the next?
This was not an influenza-induced seizure. I've never seen symptoms like these on the continent.
Neither have I. But the previous symptoms leading up to this attack were the same, indistinguishable from the epidemic.
No. There was something more vile in these reactions. Something primitive.
There have been numerous reports of mental breakdowns caused by the fever that accompanies the flu itself, Doctor.
Yes, but... I'd best take some samples of the blood for analysis.
My bedside manners. I suspect it was more than intuition alone that led you to us. So, how might I be of service, Dr. Reed?
I've come to put an end to this insufferable blackmailing, Dorothy.
Doctor, you think your warnings scare me? I've stolen and plied, blackmailed and lied, but what else am I to do? I'm all these people have.
But why Lady Ashbury? Why her, of all people?
She's pristine and proper, all right, but that she-wolf in sheep's clothing murders the poor for sport. I have her where she belongs, and I'll milk her for all she's got.
Dr. Swansea is a sensible and honest man. He wouldn't have refused your friend's care at Pembroke.
It's easy for you to say, Doctor. These people cannot go to the police, nor to the hospital. They don't even speak English. They depend on me for everything.
So, the end justifies the means. Is that your defense?
I know you're kind, Doctor. Just another fine-heeled, silver-spooned gentleman who was given the world on a platter. You know nothing of poverty, nothing of the shame, the hunger, the loneliness.
You've convinced me of the sincerity of your actions and their noble justifications. But all the same, blackmail is a crime, and it will stop, Nurse Crane.
So, are you going to turn me over to the authorities?
No. Your place is here. Jailing you would be an even greater crime. So, here is my proposition. I'll look the other way on your little enterprise. In exchange, you will resign from the Pembroke Hospital and provide me with medical supplies when the need arises.
Dr. Reed, that sounds like a business proposition. My accomplice, then.
No. Just a privileged client. My research may require the occasional rare piece of equipment or ingredient. I'll pay good coin in exchange, fair and honest, to help finance your noble endeavors.
We have ourselves a deal, Doctor. Good customers are always welcome.
Yes, Nurse Crane. We have a deal. It's locked.